that just works.
What's up, everyone? In this issue of Motive Tech, we take a look at a traction control system that actually works. Now, like most car enthusiasts, I hate traction control. And that's not because I want to do burnouts and go drifting every time I get in the car. It's because factory traction control systems are quite often very intrusive. In fact, I actually find that traction control systems can be more dangerous in a modified performance car, and you're better off just having it turned off. And that's simply because if you're halfway through a corner and the traction control system kicks in and cuts all of the power, it can make the car straighten up, go into a tank slapper, and you can crash. The only traction control systems that I've ever used where I can say it actually increases the performance of the car is in high-end supercars, things like your Ferrari 488 Pista, McLaren 720S, or motorsport traction control systems like you might find in a GT3 car. But in a regular run-of-the-mill performance or factory production car, and especially older sports cars, the traction control system is, well, quite simply put, just a very dumb item designed to help them get a 5-star safety rating. So when Powertune Australia gave me a call and said, we have a traction control system that will blow your mind, come and have a drive, who was I to say no to driving a 1,000 horsepower Skyline? Let's check it out.
So the fundamental difference between what you would typically find in an everyday consumer vehicle and a motorsports vehicle is that the ones, the traction control systems that exist in those consumer vehicles are primarily designed to be safety. So really, if you get into a situation where the tires are spinning uncontrollably, stop it immediately and straighten the car up. In a motorsport application, on the other hand, they're essentially trying to be better than the driver and accelerate as fast as the vehicle possibly can with a given tire on a given surface. Where there's human error with your foot on the throttle pedal, this takes that out and basically controls all of that for you. So once you start modifying a vehicle, the factory traction control systems can pretty much become a hindrance, a safety concern really. The reason being is that these factory systems are designed typically to close the throttle. Now, what that does is basically removes all power and very, very fast. So what you can have is a situation where you might come into a corner, the car steps sideways slightly, that system then pretty much immediately snaps the throttle closed, and you end up in a situation where you're snap oversteer, or you know, basically upsets what you're expecting the car to do, and can actually cause you to crash the car. So most aftermarket engine management systems have some form of traction control written into them. Typically they're quite crude. They generally introduce an ignition cut based reduction in torque, which can be quite violent and quite harsh on engine components. So there's a number of different ways that we can actually reduce torque to an engine, and they are typically closing the throttle, which is what the OEM typically uses. This method is actually quite slow in the terms of when it comes to aftermarket control. There's ignition timing reduction. So this can occur basically on the next power stroke. We can reduce the ignition timing and therefore reduce the amount of torque being produced. We can perform an ignition cut, which essentially removes all torque from that firing event because the cylinder doesn't actually fire at all, or you may actually randomize the misfire throughout the engine cycle. And they're pretty much the typical ones. Then we also have some other options such as removing boost and some other little bits and pieces as well. Now, typically in the aftermarket, most systems that exist out there use ignition cut, and some also combine in ignition retard. Now, the problem with using ignition cut is that it's quite hard on the engine. Effectively, it's the exact same as an engine speed limiter. Now, an engine speed limiter, if you sit on the limiter all day, you're likely to break lots of different things. In order to prevent that from happening, other systems should be used, such as reducing the boost level and reducing ignition timing. They're the first two that will actually work quite quickly at reducing torque and producing consistent torque. What that means is that you're not interrupting it and having, say, for example, 500 newton meters of torque being delivered to the rear wheels, and then instantly all of a sudden that goes to 100 and then back to 500 again, because that typically shakes the tire, shakes the driveline, unloads and loads everything in the car, and causes more problems as well. The platform that's provided to us by Motec, which is the M1 build platform, which allows us to basically build our own ECU firmware, allows us to write our own traction strategies, and optimize things in ways that we know works or that we've tested. So the difference that you're about to see with the car that we're about to take for a drive is basically we've written our own traction system. This system utilizes ignition timing and boost as the primary method to reduce power or torque to the tire. And we can do this very, very fast. So like I mentioned, we can pull ignition timing on the next firing stroke for the engine. So as soon as the tire starts to slip, we can immediately start to reduce the torque. Now, the system requires a couple of different inputs. Now, they are wheel speeds, typically. G-force, which is the ECU's actually already got built into it. And what we can also do is we can target different slip percentages. So where we can program in, let's say target of 5%, the rear wheels will be 5% faster than the fronts, and that will be the target speed. So we're not targeting exact lockup of front to rear wheel speed. Now, to reach the maximum point of acceleration, you actually need a small amount of slip on those rear wheels. Now, the other problem with targeting the exact front wheel speed is that you'll end up with a situation where the tire slips and then doesn't slip and slips and then doesn't slip, and you end up with the system cutting on and off, on and off. Rather than a situation where if you're targeting 5% slip, the system becomes enabled as soon as there's a small amount of slip, and the system then becomes closed loop controlled and basically oscillates around sort of your target speed. Basically, because we implement this 5% slip, we get a much smoother traction event. So when the traction control kicks in, you generally don't really feel it. I mean, you know that the engine's being pulled down, you can actually audibly hear that, but you don't hear a cut, it doesn't upset you in the car, you still feel the G-forces pushing you backwards in the seat, and control of the car is much more, you know, it's a lot easier to control the car. With our aftermarket traction control system, effectively there's different levels of slip and how far the car goes and what we actually do. Now, initially, if we just break above that 5% target, we might start to reduce our ignition timing. That's the first thing that we might like to do. Beyond that, we might like to reduce a small amount of boost additionally as well. And if we find, for example, that the ignition timing is too retarded for too long, typically we can also slightly close the throttle and bring the timing back up to make up for that. And then once we've really exceeded it, say for example, we hit a puddle or something uncontrollably, we implement a cut, because at the end of the day, that reduces all torque completely. So if we've got to get to that point, we can get to that point, but the system is tiered so that it doesn't have to reach that point immediately. So one of the reasons that you can't feel it is that the system operates at around about 1,000 Hertz. Now that's 1,000 times a second that the car's taking a sample of the wheel speed. It's seeing what the engine's doing and it's making adjustments. So you don't feel that. That's simply too fast for you to feel. You will feel when it gets to a cut, because the engine simply cuts all torque. However, the small management portion, when we remove, say, 1 pound of boost, 3 degrees of timing, we put that back in and we shuffle it around, that happens so fast that you will not feel it. Now, as far as the tunability portion of this, for tuners and other people to actually utilize this system, it's super simple. So effectively, you target a slip aim that you want the tires to be at. You provide the inputs like wheel speed, steering angle, brakes, you know, accelerator, and everything else. And the system is then closed loop. So you can adjust the gain. So essentially how aggressive the system is or how fast it makes changes, but you don't have to worry about, do I remove boost? Do I remove timing? Do I do this? We've already programmed that in there. Now this traction control system comes in all of our firmware packages that you can purchase through us. And it's free of charge. We've included it for everybody. The final thing that I do want to add that is certainly very surprising for some people is that this traction control can also work on a four-wheel drive vehicle. Now you're probably thinking, well, how do you actually know how fast the car is going when all four wheels are spinning? Now, we've done this and tested with a GPS. Now, the GPS has to be a particular unit that we can supply. It basically reads your current GPS position very, very fast, and we're able to then link the wheel speeds to that GPS speed. And effectively, you can have a car, say for example, a 2000 horsepower GTR that spins all four wheels immediately off the line, you can apply traction control to that based on the ground speed from the GPS.
That's pretty epic.
Yeah, that one's a really good one, but I don't have a car to show you it. So now we're gonna go out, we'll go for a drive. We'll take two different cars out. First one will be an S15. Car's billet block, 3582 Gen 2. Car makes around sort of 500, 550 kilowatts at the hubs, thereabouts. Generally a pretty drivable car in terms of, you know, power delivery and stuff like that. Now the car is on small tyres. Now when I say small, 245 Michelin tyres, it's not race slick, so it doesn't have hoosiers on it. And this car typically is controllable when it wheel spins. You can pedal the car and it will still drive, albeit not, you know, amazingly fast.
So now rolling in second, exact same place,
yep.
Exact same bit of road, exact same way. All right, now it's fast.
The second car being R33 GTR, much bigger turbo, car makes around 1,000, just a bit over 1,000 horsepower. Power delivery is totally different, almost instantaneous. It's got a sequential gearbox. That car, not really a car that you can pedal very easily. Essentially breaks out into wheel spin and will sit at 9,500 RPM banging away at the limiter. So that's a really good example of a car that's kind of very, very undrivable in the circumstances of traction. So what we'll do is we'll take it out in two-wheel drive first, just to show you just how violent it is in two-wheel drive, show that we can actually control the car in two-wheel drive and still actually accelerate with that power in two-wheel drive. Let's give it a go.
So same bit of road, same gear, same power setting, same everything, just traction control now set to 5% slip.
Sounds good.
Let's do it. Wow. That is now a fast car that works.
Yeah.
I noticed, you know, this change in engine note and things like that, but there's no pops, there's no bangs, there's no violence to it. It's just constant management of power to keep traction, and it's going.
And the car is much easier to drive from a driver's point of view.
Yeah.
As you would have seen in two-wheel drive, you've got to do a fair bit of steering input.
Yeah.
You're doing a whole bunch of pedaling, a whole heap of steering. With traction on, that is literally just mashed to the floor, hardly any steering, and just pull gears.
Okay, so we're back from the drive. I've downloaded the log from the GDR at the moment, and we can have a bit of a look through this, and I'll show you exactly what the system is doing in terms of, you know, wheel speed and things like that. We can actually see how fast the rear wheels were going, how fast the front wheels are going, and what was actually happening inside the car at the time. So the first hit that I'm going to demonstrate was the second gear, basically roll onto the throttle, and then the small amount of pedaling that I did or was able to do in the GDR. So basically you can see here, I've put my foot flat on the floor. We're now building boost. As the car comes on boost, we jump from around sort of 5 pounds of boost almost immediately to around sort of 25 pounds of boost. Now that ultimately ends up with the rear wheel speeds doing around 132 kilometers an hour, whilst the fronts are only doing 80. You can see I've had a bit of an attempt at pedaling, which basically drops the car from, you know, say around about sort of 25 pounds of boost, almost instantly down to 1 pound of boost. The car then immediately comes back up, makes 26 pounds of boost. I pedal it again down to about 50% throttle. You'll see it drops back down again to around 7 pounds of boost this time. And as I'm doing this, you can see the rear wheel speed basically jumping up and down. It really does not move forward. The rear wheels just go straight into wheel spin. The car goes straight to the limiter and it just doesn't accelerate. So we're still in two wheel drive. We then performed our second hit with traction control turned on. So what I'll do is I'll zoom in on this section here. And what you can see again is basically rolling onto the throttle. I go to 100% throttle again. The car's at about 4.5 grand, 4.5 pounds of boost. You start to see, as we start to speed up and the car starts to make boost, we get to around about sort of 12 pounds or thereabouts whilst I'm at 100% throttle, about 5,300 RPM. You'll start to see the rear tire break away from the front. You can see that here where we're doing about 81 kilometers an hour on the rear wheels and 76 on the front. So as that happens, our system basically takes over. We start to reduce ignition timing, start to maybe try and control the boost a bit better, which you can see here where the boost, instead of coming up like a sharp line, actually starts to try and roll over a small bit. And you can see that traction is basically maintained at our aim of around about 5%. So the rear wheels are doing about 100, while the front's doing about 91 kilometers an hour. So that's around about sort of 10% at that point. So the system's working pretty hard here to try and hold the car. And you can see that the boost is actually winding back out of the car to try and maintain that slip percentage there. So you can see as we get up through the gears, so around 8,300 RPM, you can see 125 Ks an hour on the rear wheels and 117 on the front. So, and then we perform a gear shift with the clutch coming off the accelerator to really upset the balance of the car and basically jam the power back on, slap the throttle back to the floor. And you can see here the boost again comes up and tries to sort of nose over. It's trying to control that boost curve and stop it from coming on really, really hard. We're pulling ignition timing and controlling that slip, which you can see here pretty much follows the same rate of acceleration as the front tires. So effectively, we still have a great amount of forward drive. In this particular example, when we've given it the hit with the traction control on, the car genuinely feels like a 500, 600 kilowatt four-wheel drive car. It doesn't actually feel rear-wheel drive, apart from the fact that we know it is, it actually feels like a four-wheel drive car. So effectively, if you've got something like a GDST and you don't have the benefit of four-wheel drive, you might be currently driving around on Mickey Thompson's or Hoosiers to try and gain as much traction as you can get, and they're probably still spinning, especially in the lower gears. If you implement a traction control system such as this one, effectively, you're going to accelerate at pretty much the same rate as a GTR would. There's going to be marginal differences, especially if you're on a radial tire. Your acceleration rate with this system enabled is going to be as good as you can get. You will not accelerate faster with the pedal. So one of the benefits of this system really is that it makes it safer to drive. So typically now we're seeing GDRs well over 1,000 horsepower, 1,400 plus horsepower. Now, if you were to give the cars or the keys to a novice driver, that's a recipe for disaster, really. This system tries to make that as good as it can be. So where there's not, you know, massive amounts of wheel spin and, you know, a whole bunch of steering input required to try and hold the car steady, this holds the car at the limit of the traction. That means that because there's more traction, less, you know, attempting to overcorrect the car, and therefore it's a safer car to drive.